I'm actually feeling like my nerves have sort of just settled down a bit, which is good. So that's good. Welcome to the Weather Bureau's online Facebook chat session. We apologise for the delays. We really appreciate you hanging online and joining in. So thank you everyone for coming along. So today, I'm Jenny Sturrock. I'm one of our senior meteorologists here at the Weather Bureau. And we're discussing some of the science and the photography behind one of our images that we've posted in the 2019 calendar. So today, I've got the pleasure of being joined by Andrew Thomas. Thank you, Andrew, for joining us.
My pleasure, Jenny. It's a big thrill for me to get in the calendar and to follow it up with this interview today.
Excellent. Now, let's cut straight to your image because it is an amazing one. Tell us where you captured the fog and, any little sort of details you'd like to go on there.
Well, that particular image was taken at Mount Buninyong. I'm from Ballarat, and a lot of people know where that is, but Mount Buninyong is about 15 kilometres away. And it's a spot that I visit on a regular basis because I know that quite often I'll get some lovely foggy conditions there. As you could see, I did that day. And what makes that one a little bit different from a lot of the other pictures I've taken there is that one was taken with the drone.
Fantastic. So we'll get to the drone in a minute, but is there any other weather phenomena that you like to capture as well? Because fogs can be tricky. Sometimes we generally get the fog develop overnight when the temperatures can cool under calm wind conditions. And then a great opportunity where there's just enough light, the fog can be thick enough or wispy enough, depending on what mood you want to capture. So are you often out and about in those early hours of the morning?
Well, yes, look, I've made a point of getting up and getting out there early. You know, usually I get to wherever I'm going well before the sunrise and just scout out the area and see what's going to develop on that particular morning. But as you said, with the fog, sometimes you just can't predict it. So I think that's what makes it a bit more of a challenge that, you know, it's not just the same thing every old time you go out there.
Absolutely. And do you get any other phenomena like frosts or things like, or a beautiful sunrise as well, which could be just sort of handy?
Sunrises and sunsets, of course. But anyone that knows the Ballarat district knows its reputation for being a fairly cold place. So we do get a lot of frosts there during the winter, which can create some fabulous conditions too. You know, I've taken pictures in the past that it's looked like it's snowed, but it's actually a field or a paddock just covered in frost. So, we get a lot of nice things up that way.
Excellent. Now, look, we've got everyone sending their questions through online, and we really appreciate that. So one question we're often getting asked is about the drone photography. So I think it's a great time to come back to that now. What are some of the restrictions? And I know you're not the expert here, but people would appreciate you've got the experience. What are some of the restrictions that people who might be starting out should be aware of?
Well, probably there's two or three main things that you have to be totally aware of. And one of them is that you have to have the drone always within line of sight. So you can't fly it out of sight. You know, obviously you need to see where it is at all times to know what's going on. Another one of the main things that you have to be aware of is not flying it over groups of people. You know, and that's a fairly obvious one too, because if something goes wrong, the last thing you want to do is for it to land on some young kid's head.
That's right.
And look, another one of the major things that you've got to be aware of too is that I've just lost the train of thought there. But look, they're the two main ones, I think, that you need to be aware of. And it just came back. You're not supposed to fly more than 400 feet or say 120 metres in height above where you're flying. And that's obviously you don't want to get up really high and potentially get in the way of anything that's flying around up there as well.
And when you're sort of flying your drone through, say, a fog event or, dare I say it, accidentally a shower occurs, is there any damage that occurs to the drone?
Look, generally I won't fly through a fog. I've flown next to fog banks and that's the best way, but occasionally with the fog moving through, you do find that, you know, you're being enveloped by the fog itself and so you have to bring the drone back home. And I've found sometimes that the drone on landing has literally been dripping with water.
Wow.
I had another occasion on another place up near Mount Warrenheat, which is near Ballarat as well, where I flew it in some snow. It was snowing one one morning back in September last year, and I thought, this is something pretty unique. I think I've got to take a bit of a chance here. And I got some awesome footage and some terrific photos of that. But generally, we try not to fly it in those adverse conditions.
Yeah, fair enough. Now, look, we've got some more coming through. Kaz wants to know, what's the most unique weather phenomena that you have photographed, Andrew? Thank you, Kaz.
Look, I really love particular clouds, and something you don't see too often is a thing called mammatus clouds. I'm sure, Jenny, you know what they are. And they're always something that get me excited because they're just so unusual occurrence. I don't know if you could go and whoever's, you know, wants to go and look them up as a Google image search, but they're incredible things. And you know, I would say in the last dozen years or so that I've been chasing the weather, that I've only come across half a dozen occurrences of good ones. So that's one of the ones that, and of course lightning is always exciting stuff, you know, it's just the power. It really shows you what nature can do to us if we don't behave, you know, and it's exciting stuff when you're out in the middle of a thunderstorm.
Yeah, absolutely. And we've got some beautiful images of lightning and storms in the weather calendar. And look, just being able to capture those beautiful lightning bolts. So we get the lightning develop when we've got a build-up of energy. So in the thunderstorm, we've got the ice crystals and the water vapor droplets. And when they're moving up and down inside the thunderstorm, we get a disconnection of charge. So we get positive charge at the top of the storm, negative on the bottom, and when that charge amplifies and breaks, that's when we get the lightning strike. So obviously, being lightning and an electrical charge, we do need to be careful. And the Weather Bureau, we do issue severe thunderstorm warnings through our webpage, so you always should be up to date with those. And then obviously what we call the garden variety storms can still be dangerous as well, but still impressive to photograph. So,
And look, I really appreciate the Bureau's forecast for these storms because that's what gets me excited. As soon as I see one on the Bureau's webpage or something like that, that's a sign for me to get in the car and go chasing and see what I can find. And it's great to be able to have that access to the Bureau stuff to be able to do that.
Oh, fantastic. Look, I'm glad that's good. So Andy Smith's joined the conversation. His image of the double rainbow in the calendar. So he's asking how the double rainbows are formed. You know, thank you so much for joining online. So we basically get, as the light is passing through raindrops in the atmosphere, we get the light bending and also reflecting, and that's sort of spreading the light ray out. So we get those beautiful colours forming. So that's some of the ways that we can see some of those rainbows. And we've also got another question come through. Thank you, Aaron. We've also got the diamond dust and halo question from Andrew. From Aaron. Well, the diamond dust, that was taken in Antarctica. And when you've got the colder air mass, what you're actually able to do is form the ice crystals close to the surface. So when the sun's rays passing through, it's again being bent or refracted off those ice crystals, forming a beautiful halo. It's often called diamond dust. So it's something obviously not many people can get down to Antarctica, but we do get cold air masses over southern parts of the country. So maybe it might not be as elusive as we think, but certainly something if you're ever going to do a photography journey and try and capture one of them. We've also got William, who said there was some great mammatus clouds in Ballarat today. So you must have been on the train ride coming in, so you've missed that opportunity.
you're really rubbing it in here. I got on the train at, I think it was just after 10 o'clock, and I could see something developing locally, and I thought, wow, I'm going to miss out here. So, but it's nice to see that he's managed to see it and appreciate, and it's so relevant to what we've just been talking about.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, just before we sort of get too sidetracked, I'd love to come back to the drone. Now, Andrew, you've brought one in. Do you mind just sort of lifting that up so we can see that one and just sort of explaining, especially for those who are starting to get out into drone photography?
Well, this is one of those smaller ones that you can get. There's a big range these days, but this is one that's particularly well known, and it's an amazing little machine. And you can send it up. What you do is that you have your tablet or your phone on a remote control, and you use that to view what this little camera is seeing up in the air there. And so I'm fully aware of what the drone is seeing when it's up in the air, and it's just a matter of taking the photos, of course. And this gives you tremendous flexibility to position where you want to take your photos from. And they're amazing little machines. And this is, as I mentioned, one of the smaller ones. that's out there these days, but there are much bigger ones that you can get, which, you know, can take up fully professional cameras if that's where you want to go with that sort of thing.
So this smaller one would be something, if someone was starting out, you would sort of recommend, or...?
Something fairly small, yeah. I mean, with a lot of things, it's the more you spend... With the drones, I've found, is basically the more you'll spend, the better camera you will get.
Oh, okay.
So it's, if you want to get up into semi-professional and then professional levels, then it's a bit like any gear. You just keep increasing it if you find that that's where you want to go with it.
And of course, you've always got to be prepared to lose it. Have you lost your drone in any occasions before?
Jenny, we talked about this. You weren't supposed to ask me about that. But yes, I lost one a year or so ago in one of the local lakes in Burrumbeet. And look, it was totally my fault. I can't even blame the company that makes the machines. I was a long way from the drone and I backed it into a tree and it fell into the lake. So look, it's just one of those things. One of the rules of drone flying is that if you're going to do it, you're going to lose one. So hopefully that's it for my lifetime.
Fantastic. Now, I appreciate your honesty there. Now, Kaz online, thanks again, Kaz, for your question come through. So she wants to know, Andrew, whether you prefer photography with drones or the traditional camera?
That's a great question, because I have been doing a lot of landscape photography from ground level, and then I think I've been flying the drone for 3 or 4 years now, and I find I'm going back to the same locations I used to go to at ground level and shooting them, but from 100 or 200 feet or even 50 feet, you know. And I must admit, at the moment, it's the drone photography that's really got me excited, because it just opens up a totally new viewpoint. But one thing I think it's worth mentioning with drone photography is initially you get so excited that you're 100 feet above the ground and you're looking down and it's a terrific picture because you've never seen it before. But you still need the good conditions. You still need the beautiful early morning light or the fog to make that picture even something better. And that's something that I think carries over from doing land, you know, ground-based photography.
And so how many images would you have to take on a drone to get the perfect one, versus is that more than traditional photography?
I don't think I've taken the perfect one yet.
You're still, too still kind. Well, the weather calendar one.
I'm still searching for it. But no, look, I probably take a lot more pictures than I will ever need when I'm flying the drone, and even at ground level too, I take a lot. But I found the way I do my photography is that quite often I can line up the shot, and one of the initial views that I get is the one that I find the best shot. But with digital photography these days, we've got this unlimited capacity to take hundreds of photos. So you take hundreds of photos from all different angles, different heights. Mm. But quite often I'm surprised that it's that first one or two pictures that is the picture.
Is the one.
Yeah.
Now, just jumping back to lightning, there's a great lightning show unfolding today near Geelong. And Aaron would like to know, what's the best camera setting for capturing lightning, if that's something that you've...
Lightning is a hard one to catch, especially during the day, because it's so random, it can just flash and that's it. I find lightning is best captured around dusk, but it's just a matter of setting your camera on a fairly standard setting and hoping that you get that actual bolt, whereas in the middle of the day that's almost impossible to do. But one thing I've tried when you're shooting in the day, say, and there's a good lightning, so quite often you'll get a double bolt. So if you're looking, and like, you will never capture the picture of that first bolt, but if you then take a picture, you may just strike it lucky to get that second bolt if it comes through. But another thing too, when you're shooting at dusk or even in the dark, the best way to do it, I find, is to have your camera on a tripod and set the camera for, say, a long exposure, say maybe 20 or 30 seconds, take the picture, and then hopefully in that 30 seconds when the camera is, you know, exposing the image, you might get the bolt of lightning. And that's I find, the best. And I think that's a fairly standard way to capture it. So, you know, and with digital photography too, you do get the option to check your images as they go. So if it's overexposed, you can underexpose it, just pull things back a bit. So it gives you a bit of instant feedback. So hopefully you can capture something that, you know, you might enter in the next calendar.
Yeah, absolutely. We're always looking for the next year's worth of calendar images. Now, Brad's asked whether, Andrew, you use filters on your drone or, on the lenses for the drones.
I don't really use filters as such. No, I do use them on my land-based, you know, my ground-based camera. I certainly use a polarising filter a lot on that. But with With the drone, I haven't really found the need to do that, except on the odd occasion. I have actually used the drone to photograph waterfalls and to get that silky smooth look on the waterfall that we all love, and I think you've got it on your screen
over
there.
Yeah, I love them.
You need to slow the shutter speed right down. So I do use a neutral density filter, which slows the shutter speed down. And that's one of the amazing things about these drones is that you can still take these long exposure pictures with the camera flying 100 feet in the air. They're incredibly stable sometimes. So, but that's about it. I haven't really got into the video side of drone photography, and I know there's a lot of filters that get used for that to get that right sort of feel to the motions of video, but I haven't really gone to that stage yet.
So that might help answer this next one that Keith's asked. He just wanted to know whether you've done hyperlapse for capturing the fog as it sort of rolls in or rolls out.
No, that's another good question, and I would love to say that I have done it, and I've seen many examples online of the amazing things that's creating, and it's something that's definitely on my agenda to have a bit of a go of. And even, once again, that's the sort of thing that the drone can handle, or to do it from ground level still works particularly well as well, yeah.
Fantastic. And just probably one of the last ones, sunrise and sunset, that we can get some amazing colours. What's some of the best settings that you might use for trying to capture that rich colour?
Sunrises and sunset, that colour is actually quite a challenge to capture, because quite often you'll find you might capture the beautiful colour in the sky, but the foreground might go black. Or if you're capturing the foreground and trying to get that, the sky will bleach out and you'll lose all that lovely colour. So it's something that you have to, I think, practice a bit. I know on a lot of cameras these days, and on phones in particular, there's a function called HDR, which is high dynamic resolution, and that'll take a special picture that combines the best of both, so you'll get the nice colour and then some detail in the foreground as well, and it blends it in the camera to do that for you. Otherwise, the traditional way that a lot of people do it is to take two pictures and then you need to put it on the computer and do a bit of work on the computer to use the best pieces of each photo to hopefully match what you saw that morning.
Fantastic. Well, look, we've run out of time, but we just wanted to say thanks again, everyone, for joining us online. Look, I'd just like to tell you my favourite type of weather. I absolutely love cirrus clouds. To me, they're just the beautiful, white, wispy nature of them, the upper levels of the atmosphere, and probably be one of my favourites. What about you, Andrew? Other than fog, you do love fog?
Yeah, I love second my fog, best? Obviously. Second best, I think, is lightning, but I don't get many chances. Snow. I do love snow. You know, the few times I've been overseas and managed to find some snow, and like living in Ballarat, as cold as it is, we only had one decent snowfall last year, so that's pretty exciting when it's so irregular, you know. So,
great. Yeah, sounds like there's more challenges for you for the next year's calendar.
Yeah, absolutely.
So everyone just remember too, the competition is still open till March for 2020's calendar, so we'll be looking for more great entries. Thank you again for joining online, and we'll talk to you all soon, and if there's any further questions, please keep posting. We'll endeavour to answer them too. Thank you.
Thank you.